my freedom.
All right.
Look to somebody and say, there's a necessary constraint to my freedom. You can have your seats here. This afternoon, I come to talk to those of you who have been experiencing a little bit of warfare. It's really easy to talk to those who have been experiencing warfare when you have gone through something. Is there anybody in this room who say, I can relate with going through? I can relate with going through. I can relate with trouble. I can relate with trial. But I was talking to my mother on the other day, and we came up with a little tag team thing. She said, I said, I've been living and learning. And then she said, you know what? You're not living and learning unless you're learning while you're living. Because I come to understand this, young people, I come to understand this. It's not what you go through, it's what you learn while you're in what you went through. A lot of people go through stuff, but they don't get the necessary lessons. They don't get the necessary lessons that God is teaching. You ought to look to your neighbor and say, there's a lesson in your trial. There's a learning in your tribulation. God's trying to teach you something. And so for all of you who've been going through, look for the lesson. You know what I understand, Pastor Carter? As soon as you get the lesson, you can come out of it. I wish I had somebody in here. As soon as you learn what it is God's trying to teach you, then he'll snatch you out. It don't take God long to snatch you out. It don't take God long to pull you out. But when God is ready to pull you out, when God is ready to change your situation, he'll do it in a moment's notice. Why don't you nudge somebody and say, it's my time now, because I learned the lesson. You didn't tell the right person yet. Tell them, I learned the lesson. Yeah, I learned how to suffer. I learned how to go through. But I learned how to go through and keep my praise. To learn while you're going through something. And so now you can stop. Now we understand that the enemy is fighting you in your mind. Look to somebody and say, the battle is taking place in your mind. Perception, I've learned that perception is everything. Old saying, saints, you can choose to look at a cup and see it as half empty, or you can look at the cup and see it as half full. It just depends on how you want to look through it, how you want to look at it. But because we are children of God, because we are sons of God, because we are the redeemed of the Lord, we don't look at things the same way that the world would look through it. We don't look at warfare. We don't look at tribulation the same way as the world would deem it. Yeah, because the world would look at it and say, you lost your car, and that must mean something's going on. But you'll look at it because you're spiritual and say, I lost that car because greater is on the way. The world would look at it and say, your husband left you. You must not have been a good wife. Your wife left you, you must not have been a good husband. But when you're spiritual, you'll look at it and say, I did things right. I did things the right way. And if they didn't appreciate me, kick them to the curb. You got to get a Beyonce in your spirit. You must not know about me, because I have another you in a minute. As a matter of fact, you ought to prophesy to somebody who done gone through some relationship problems and say, he on the way, she on the way. I wish I had somebody excited right there. Because the enemy wants you to look at things the wrong way. He wants you to look at things the wrong way. But tell somebody, you got to look through spiritual eyes. Because we understand that we are being beings of flesh, but we are living in a spiritual realm. We are spiritual beings in a fleshly realm, but we understand supernaturally that there is something that we cannot see out of our natural eyes called the spiritual realm. I like the way Elijah said it when he looked at his servant and there were warriors against him. He said, look through your spiritual eyes and you'll see that there'll be more that are for us than they that are against us. I want to prophesy to somebody and say it might look bad, but it ain't like what it looks like. I want to prophesy to somebody and tell you it might look like the odds are stacked against you, but the Lord said those are just stepping blocks. Oh, y'all miss that. It might look like the odds are stacked up, trouble is stacked up against you, but you ought to look at your warfare. You ought to look at your enemies and relate it to the scripture that says he'll make your enemies your footstool. Oftentimes we relate that to folk, but you ought to look at the bills that are in your face and say, you my footstool. I'm going to pay these bills now so that I can get to the next level. Y'all ain't talking yet. You ought to look at when people stab you in the back and step on top of that. Say, that ain't nothing. I'm going to greater, because you got a mind that is focused on greater. Is there anybody in the room that will prophesy to yourself and say, there is greater? This is what the word declares. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Tell somebody, greater's on the inside of you. You ain't told him yet. I said, tell him, greater's on the inside of you. And the reason why the devil's fighting you is because he's trying to stop greater. But he that hath begun a good work shall perform it. I wish I had some word lovers in here. To the day of Jesus Christ, you ought to prophesy and testify. What the Lord started, he ain't going, he going to finish it. What the Lord started to bless you some years ago. The Lord started to give you a miracle, honey. He put his foot, he put his hand to the plow, and God's going to complete it. Find you somebody and slap hands with that person and say, God's going to complete the work in your life. Oh, y'all ain't excited enough. I said, tell them God's going to complete the work in your life. Oh, y'all way too quiet. Come on, yell it at them. Say, God's going to complete the work in your life.
Okay, so let's go to the text. We don't have that much time, so we understand that the enemy is fighting our mind. And so it is interesting to me, Lady Carter, it is interesting to me, Auntie, that the Lord would give us the scripture concerning Paul, because we understand that Paul declares that he is a prisoner of Christ. But he says something very interesting. He says that I am a prisoner not for my sake, but I am a prisoner for your sake. He says, I am not a prisoner. I'm not going through what I'm going through for myself. Have you ever been experiencing some warfare? Have you ever experienced something that you could not explain why you're going through it? Is there anybody in this room that can testify that you've gone through some things and you literally had to question, Lord, why me? You literally had to question, maybe you were like me a couple of weeks ago, and I said, Lord, help me to make sense out of this. Is there anybody who can say, I don't understand why it is that I'm going through, but can I help you understand something? The imprisonment, the thing, the bondage that you were going through was not for you, but it was for somebody else. That's a good place to praise him right there, because now you can relate with folk. Let me tell you about me. Years ago, I was very, 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 my sister could tell you, arrogant. I was arrogant. I didn't know how to relate with folk because I hadn't gone through enough stuff. But after you've gone through something, you learn how to humble yourself. Is there anybody in here that can testify that the Lord
Lord had to humble you. Amen. And every now and then, God's still humbling me. Every now and then, God still has me. It's like unto Paul. He said, I pray first that the thorn be removed. And God said, no, my grace is sufficient for you. I want to let you know in here that God's what God is doing in your life. Yeah, you're going to learn a lesson out of it so that you can teach somebody else. Huh? You somebody shake their hand and say, you got to tell of the goodness of Jesus. You got to tell of what the Lord has done for you. And so it is interesting to me because Paul says this. He says, I am a prisoner of the Lord Jesus Christ. But then you understand in the text that Paul was writing this letter from prison. He was writing this letter from prison, and he looks at his situation, and he says, Rome, you might have me in jail. Yeah, you might have me locked up in custody. But understand this, the devil might think he has you, but it's really for the Lord. Say, the devil might think that he has you bound, but it's really for the, tell somebody something good is going to come out of this. Tell them the Lord's going to work this thing for his glory. I wish I had a church in here that didn't mind talking to somebody. Tell them the Lord's gonna work this thing for his glory. Yeah, the Lord is working this for his glory. And so he says, I am a prisoner of Christ for you. Tell somebody, say, I have to go through what I went through so that I can tell somebody else. As a matter of fact, I come to tell somebody, some of you who've gone through some things in your body, some of you have gone through some things in your life, and the Lord tells you today that you got to go find those people who went through the same thing, that are going through the same thing that you came out of, and help somebody else. This is the problem with the church, Lady Carter. The church is too selfish. Y'all made me go here. Y'all weren't talking enough. I was trying to be nice, but the church is too selfish. Nobody want to do nothing for nobody else. Nobody. The church is too selfish. You go through things. You don't even want to talk to nobody. I'm scared. I'm timid. I don't like talking to folk. And that's why God keep beating you on your head until you learn how to say yes to God. That's why you keep going through the same trial after the same trial, because God's trying to get glory out of you. I wish I had some destiny pushes in here that say glory's coming out of me. Glory is coming out of me. Find you somebody and push them in their back and say glory is coming out of you. That's why you're experiencing depression, because glory is coming out of you. And any day now it shall spring forth. My God. I gotta say it again. I felt that prophetic prayer. Any day now the glory of the Lord shall spring forth out of your life. You ought to slap hands with somebody and say, I'm coming out of this. You don't got to know what my this is. Just know when you seek me out, know I survived it. Just know when you see me driving it, know I came out of it. Just know that by the next time that you see me, the Lord is going to make the work the miracle in my life. Somebody shout miracle. All right, so here it is. I'm going to find your key. Here it is that that Paul was in prison, and he writes and he says, I'm not in prison for myself, but he says, I'm in prison for you. I've come to understand sometimes, Pastor, you've got to step away. Sometimes you've got to step away and take your hands off of it. This is what the old saint said. They said, step back and let God do it. I wish I had an old church in here that didn't mind talking back to me. And she stepped back and let the Lord do it. You ought to look to somebody and say, whatever it is you're going through, take your hands off of it. Whatever it is you've been experiencing, whatever it is you've been praying about, take your hands off of it. And the Lord, come on, let's preach it here. Tell somebody, say, the Lord is going to work it out. Say, the Lord is going to make a way. The Lord is going to work it out. Tell somebody, say, I feel a miracle in your back door. Tell them, I feel a miracle. I
wish I had some prophetic faux pas that really just caught that. I need to make that up. I just said it. I said I feel a miracle in your back door. What are you saying, prophet? That the blessings of the Lord shall overshadow you and overtake you. And it ain't coming from the front, but if you look behind you, you'll see a miracle. You're trying to run from the past, but if you look behind you, you'll see there's a miracle, and it's coming. And the only thing you've got to do is stand still and see the salvation. I wish I had some church folks in here. Just don't play that man. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. Shall be yes.
All right.
So here it is. Y'all got to play. I'm going to preach with no music today. I want you to get this word. Here it is that Paul is in prison and it's hard. Has anybody ever been in prison here? Don't wait here. I want you to tell the story. But it's a hard place to be bound and captive, but you still look at it with the right perception. So this brings me back to the text now in Romans chapter 8. This brings me to the text in Romans chapter 8. I like that key because before you can get to Romans chapter 8, you've got to go down to Romans chapter 7. And young people, you got to really get this. The Bible talks about, he says, that there is a war in my members. This is in Romans chapter 7. He said, when I would do good, evil is always present. But the thing that I like about it is it lets us know that the war is taking place in his mind. Paul said, the good that I want to do, that I cannot do. Have you ever been in a place and you wanted to do something and you said, if I could do it, I would do it. If I could have it, I would have it. If I could drive it, I would drive it. Is there anybody in the room that don't mind talking to me that can testify that sometimes you really want to live right? Sometimes you really don't want to cuss some folk out. Sometimes there's a real war. Tell somebody, I really been going through. And you looking at the outside because I understand this lady Carter. People will curse your crisis. Don't judge what I'm going through because you never know how I'm internalizing something. You ought to tell somebody, please don't judge what I'm going through based on what you see. Honey, that's just the surface. Y'all ain't talking yet. But tell them that's just the surface. But there's a real war going on. And I wish I had some real sanctified folk that understood the power of prayer. That's why I like the old church. Because the old church, they could look at you smiling on the outside and still tell something. Is there anybody that said, I'm not just going to talk about the old church, but the old church lives on the inside of me. That's why some of your friends don't come around you. Because they know when they get around you, you'll be able to peg what it is. What my folk at in here? What a folk at in here that still got discernment? What a folk at in here that still got the Holy Ghost? Because that's all you need, baby, is the Holy Ghost. So here it is. Paul talks about the war that is going on in his members. Is there anybody in a war in your members? There's a war going on in your mind. There's a war going on in your spirit. It's now fighting your flesh, and your flesh is fighting your spirit. And so here it is, Paul. He comes to the conclusion that there is, therefore, now no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus. Find you somebody, and I want you to quote that scripture. I know you're talking a little bit, a lot to your neighbor. It's okay, because that word got to get in your spirit. But find you somebody and say, there is now no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus. But this is the key part, because a lot of people, Pastor Carter, they think they they are in Christ Jesus because they confess Christ Jesus. A lot of people now, Pastor, they think that they are in Christ Jesus because they confessed it with their mouth, but they didn't believe in their heart. Because baby, if you believed in your heart, something would change. If you believed in your heart, then this is what the Bible says: if you love me, then you'll keep my commandments. And so now we got a problem, because a lot of people serve a mind Jesus, a lot of people serve a mouth Jesus, but they don't serve a heart Jesus. Oh my God, a lot of people serving God with their mouth. They come to church on Sundays, Wednesdays, they even go to revivals, they go to all the musicals and shout around, but while they're in the service, they're looking for who they can go home with, because they're serving with their mouth and not with their heart. But when you get your heart right, when you get your heart right, you'll be in service, and they'll hit on you, because the devil will send you what you want. Come on here, let me talk to my sisters. The devil will send you what you want, but when your heart is right, you'll look at them and say, you are not my destiny. You might look good, you might smell good, you might even drive good, but you're not my destiny, because my destiny understands that there's destiny in me, and the only thing they want to do is to make sure I get to my destiny. That's when you know you got somebody good. It's when they want to push you to your destiny. That's when you know you got somebody right for you. It's when they look past the flesh and they say, yeah, you sexy and all, but there's a word in your belly. Yeah, you look good, but God wants you to pray. Somebody shout it. Yeah. So he says, there's a war in my members, and he comes to the conclusion that there is therefore now no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus. And here's the kicker: who walk not after the flesh. Tell somebody, I can't walk after the flesh. A lot of pastors now, Pastor Carter, are walking after the flesh. What do you mean? They're trying to go for the big churches, and they're trying to go for the big members. And if that's your destiny, that's one thing, Uncle. But if it's not, you better be comfortable with the few folk that God gave you, and work the work until they come. Oh, y'all ain't heard that. This is what the Bible declares. He says, strengthen them that remain. Maybe they might have walked off and left you, but look at the portion of God Almighty. Look at what you have left. They might have walked off and left you. You might have lost some stuff, but look at what you have left. Tell somebody, what you have left is really greater than what you had. Tell them what you had left, what you still got, is greater than what you have, because the Lord can do something in small things. I said, the Lord can do something in small things. The Lord despise not small beginnings. Who am I talking to? Despise not the small things. Despise, because the Lord's working something out in them. Almost ready to close. We got to get out of here. And so he says to them who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Tell somebody, I'm chasing spiritual things. Tell them, I'm chasing spiritual things. I was having a conversation with the preacher yesterday, and I tell him that he has that cute preaching going on, because they start off with a nice story, and then they talk about the text, and they give you 3 points, and they give you a nice hoop, and then we go home and nobody remembers. And so I said, but I'm not really focused on my style of preaching. I'm focused on the anointing. Is there anybody in the room that says, I'm really not focused on the robes, I'm not focused on the glamour, but I'm focused on the spiritual things? See, we got a lot of singers that can sing, but not a lot of singers that are anointed when they sing. We got a lot of preachers that can preach, but not a lot of preachers that are anointed when they preach. And so you got to be careful anytime you walk in a church and you see praise team leaders and they singing, but they not caught up themselves yourself. You gotta be careful when you walk into these churches and you see preachers who won't lift their hands to give God any glory. You got to be careful. And you gotta even watch yourself and make sure that it's not in you. Every now and then you ought to make sure that you cry. You ought to check and see if I still got it. You ought to check and see if I still got the Holy Ghost. Because we get so comfortable with our tongues, but you ought to check and make sure that you ain't saying these tongues out of vain repetitions. But you ought to check and make sure that, say, God, do I still got the Holy Ghost? Every now and then you ought to push yourself. See, I come here and I don't preach with notes, and I'm almost done. I promise you I am. I'm almost done. But I don't preach with notes. You know why? Because I heard a preacher by the name of Bishop Clarence McClendon one day. He said, preachers, we get up here and preach with these notes, but every now and then you ought to leave the notes at home and let the Lord speak. In that moment, the Lord will give you what to say. And now the problem is we got people and they're going to church and they ain't getting nothing. You know why? Because the preacher too caught up on their script. The preacher too caught up and they're not being spiritual enough. Find you somebody and look at them in the eye and say, maybe you got to be spiritually minded. Yeah. As a matter of fact, you got to be spiritually minded concerning what you see. So here it is in the text. He says, who walk not after the flesh, but after the spirit. Tell somebody, I'm chasing God now. Find you somebody, shake their hand. We almost ready to go home. Shake their hand and say, baby, it's time to chase God. We've been chasing after the wrong thing long enough, but it's time to chase God. You know why you got to chase God? Because Jesus is soon to come back, and he's coming back for those who've been chasing him. He's coming back for those who've been waiting on him. I'm sorry, we got to throw that part in there. And so here it is. Paul starts off Romans chapter 8 and lets you know that the enemy cannot condemn you. Understand this, and I'm almost ready. The enemy comes to condemn you for what you do, but the Holy Ghost convicts. There's a difference. The enemy will condemn you and make you feel bad, make you want to give up, but the Holy Ghost will say, that was wrong, get it right, get back in prayer and keep it moving. The enemy will make you look at yourself and say, I'm not worthy to preach, I'm not worthy to prophesy, I'm not worthy to do any of it, but the Holy Ghost will say, you're right, you're not worthy, because your righteousness is as filthy rags. But he'll let you know that God got something called a robe of righteousness that he'll place on you. And so even in your mess, God will bless you. You know what I've learned, auntie, and I'm ready to get out of here. Your message will come out of your misery. I said your message, the thing that God wants you to talk about, the thing that God wants you to preach about, the thing that God wants you to minister, your ministry will come out of your misery. If you can ever catch that in the Holy Ghost, you understand the next direction of your life. What I've been through is what I'm going to preach about. What I've come out of is what I'm going to talk about, because somebody needs what I got. Find you somebody and prophesy to them and say, somebody needs what you got. That was the wrong person. They didn't get excited. But find you somebody and look at them in the Holy Ghost. As a matter of fact, grab their hands and get ready to shake it like you got some power. And tell them, somebody needs what you got. Shake another person's hand and tell them there's a ministry in you and somebody needs what you got. Find you somebody else and say, there's a message in you and somebody needs what you got. Somebody needs to hear your story. Somebody needs to hear your testimony. Somebody needs to hear what the Lord has done for you. I dare you to find you somebody and just tell them one thing that the Lord has done for you. Just find you somebody and testify real quick. Tell them, the Lord, he brought me out. Tell the Lord, he's a healer. You got to find you somebody.